Hello, my friends. Welcome back to my channel. First things first, gotta address the elephant in the room, or the frog in the room that's also in my throat, because clearly my voice is not doing the greatest. I was going to wait to film this video until my voice got better. It has not, so I just decided to just do it. I was gonna say a cup of tea to make it seem like I'm doing the utmost to heal my respiratory system. It's coffee. Being sick does not stop the need for coffee, is what I've learned this past week. But I have coffee to soothe my throat, if it even does. Probably doesn't. But all of that is completely besides the point, because today I'm going to be doing my May wrap-up, and I read 4 works in the month of May, all of which were 4 stars, which is a pretty solid reading month, I would say. None were absolute favorites, and none were flops, so it was pretty solid. I really did enjoy all the works that I read, and I'm just going to start with the first book that I read, which is Henry VIII by William Shakespeare. Now, I never would have picked this up, probably. Well, not never, because I do want to actually read all of Shakespeare's plays, but I didn't have any immediate plans to pick it up, but I actually had tickets to see Henry VIII at the Globe, and so of course I had to read it before I saw it, because honestly it kind of helps me, because if I watch a production of Shakespeare without any prior knowledge of the play, the words start to all just blend together in my head and I can't really catch what's going on. And so of course I had to read it first, so I bought this, read it. This is a history play and it follows Henry VIII, and this follows him when he is married to his first wife, Queen Catherine, his divorce from Queen Catherine, and then his marriage to Anne Boleyn. And of course, a lot of other stuff. It doesn't really follow the marriages in the way I think we sort of fixate on that now as an aspect of Henry VIII's reign. It more so focuses on power dynamics, especially within Henry VIII's inner circle. For example, Cardinal Wolsey is a cardinal who has sort of made his way into the king's inner circle, and he's using his power for a lot of unjust things. He is taxing the people in the king's name and whatnot, and Catherine calls him out on this, and the cardinal repeatedly is able to sort of worm his way out of these allegations of treason that he is getting, up to a certain extent, and then saying anything more than that would be a spoiler. But it does heavily follow power dynamics within Henry VIII's circle and the people that are trying to use their power. It involves people being unjustly accused of treason. It's a very political play. It's not my favorite Shakespeare, for sure, by a landslide. This is not my favorite, but I do think it's very, very interesting. I would recommend this if you like Shakespeare's handling of history. I usually really do. I don't know if it's where I would start with Shakespeare's history plays, because I haven't read enough Shakespeare histories to be able to say that. I just read it because I was going to see a production of it, and I did end up enjoying it, but it's not very highly ranked on my list of Shakespeare plays, but I did give it 4 stars, so it was good. I would just be hesitant to recommend this to everyone under every circumstance, if that makes sense. Because I think if you're going to choose one Shakespeare play or one history play, I don't know if this is the one I would grab, but I did really like it. So take all that with what you will and sort of try to make an informed decision about Henry VIII, I suppose. The next book that I read, which is actually not a book, it's a short story, which is Kew Gardens by Virginia Woolf. This is extremely short. I believe it's only like 15 pages. The font is huge in this copy. Short story follows a bunch of different people as they are just living out their day in Kew Gardens. So it's very modernist in that the lens is sort of flipping from person to person. We follow a couple, we get really deep into their thoughts in the moment. We follow a pair that are walking, we follow a man and a boy. I believe it's a boy or a man and an older man and a younger man. I forgot sort of all of the people that we follow, but we are sort of just flipping. It's like a rapid sort of like camera lens showing us all of these little snippets of people's lives. And it's really just modernist, I guess. I guess that's like kind of the best way that I could describe it, but I don't know if that's the most helpful. It's pretty much just all these snippets of people are making up this story, but none of it really has any continuity or meaning in the traditional sense that a novel would have a beginning, a middle, and an end. We're just getting these rapid flashes and we're just left to sort of make what we will of it, and it's not really given any justification. But I did really love the way it was written, and it did make me want to revisit Virginia Woolf, because I read Mrs. Dalloway when I was a freshman in college, so about 3 years ago, around there, and I really didn't like it. But I do think it was sort of because I wasn't really able to understand what was going on. I had never really been introduced to modernism before, and so it was very overwhelming, I think, for me at that point in my life. But reading this was so good. I mean, it's so short, but I just thought it was so good. And the writing was really, really well done. And it really captivated me from beginning to end. And I usually don't like short stories, but I did actually really enjoy this one, even though it was incredibly, incredibly short. And it made me want to give Virginia Woolf another chance. I don't know if I should reread Mrs. Dalloway or if I should try something else like Orlando. I'm not sure. I'm not the most familiar with Virginia Woolf's works, but I do want to revisit her. And so if you have any recommendations on how I should do that, if I should reread Mrs. Dalloway, if I should try something else, please let me know because this sort of made me a convert, I think. And I thought it was a very fascinating portrayal of these little snapshots of people's lives. And it doesn't have meaning, but at the same time it does because it doesn't have meaning. I don't know if that makes sense, but anyway, that's enough about Kew Gardens. I'm going to continue with another Shakespeare. This is The Tempest by William Shakespeare. Again, probably didn't have to say that. I started this, this is actually like kind of embarrassing. I started this March 31st, and I finished it May 26th, which probably tells you something about how my semester went. But I started this as a buddy read with Sarah's perusals. We have been reading like a Shakespeare play every 3 months, I think, but I don't know if we've actually been doing every 3 months, but we've sort of been like trying our best to get a Shakespeare play in every now and then. And I started this one in March, way before she did, because I was reading it for an extra research project that I was doing. And then of course I read Act One and I clearly didn't finish it. And so we ended up finishing it at the same time in May. And this one, my thoughts are complicated on it. I almost gave it 3 stars, but then I gave it 4 stars and I can't really decide where my sort of thoughts lie on it. And let me give like a plot summary and then I can sort of give why my thoughts are very complex on it, I think. So The Tempest follows Prospero, or is it Prospero? I don't know, but follows Prospero, who is this duke that gets stranded on this island with his daughter Miranda. And when we are introduced to him, we are also introduced to his two slaves, indentured servants. I'm not really sure the word that you would use to describe them, Ariel and Caliban. And Ariel is this magic spirit that helps Prospero do what he wants to do. But when we are introduced to Ariel tells him, "I have been doing all of this work for you and you promised me my freedom, so where's my freedom?" And Prospero says, "Are you kidding? When I found you, I saved you, and so this is not an appropriate question to be asking right now." But he does promise him freedom after a certain amount of time, so he helps him conjure up this tempest, which shipwrecks a bunch of people, which it gets very complicated. But first, let me get to Caliban, who is the other servant, who is the son of the devil and a witch, I believe, are his two parents. And so he is described as misshapen. Sparrow obviously has a lot of aversion to him and he doesn't treat him well, and there's a lot of complicated things going on with Caliban. Probably write a whole dissertation on Caliban, and I'm sure people definitely have. That is Act One. And I loved Act One. I loved the exploration of these power dynamics and Prospero and these two figures, Ariel and Caliban, and the language that is used in the three in their interactions. I thought it was going to be a 5-star play. I thought it was going to overthrow Julius Caesar. But then we get to the part where the tempest is conjured and these people are shipwrecked on this island. And there's a lot of scheming going on about people being made to appear dead and marriages and just a lot of scheming. If you've read a Shakespeare comedy or just Shakespeare, it can get very convoluted very fast. And I couldn't even tell you all the characters that are involved in all of the scheming because, well, perhaps because I read it over the course of 2 months, so that was not the best way to do it, but also just because it's a very long character list. But one thing that's probably important to note is that Prospero sort of conjures his tempest because his brother is on the ship that is being shipwrecked, the brother that banished him to this island. That is probably an important aspect again. But I'm just going to say sort of why my thoughts are complicated on it. I feel like that would probably be enough. I loved Act One. When we get to the Tempest part where all these people are shipwrecked and we are dealing with all of these characters that I didn't particularly care about, if I'm being honest, I sort of started to lose that magical feeling that I had in Act One, where we are introduced to this magician and there's this angel that's involved and this son of the devil. And it was just very like, wow, this would be so cool to see on the stage. You know, it feels so magical and charged. It felt amazing. And I was like, oh my gosh, Shakespeare's such a genius. This is only gonna get better. And then when we get to the part about all of the stuff going on with the guys that are shipwrecked and then someone falling in love with Prospero's daughter Miranda, it's just I lost it, I think. I think I lost what Act One gave me. And I think it started to become sort of like something like Twelfth Night, where there's a lot of scheming and things like that, but it didn't do it in my favorite way, if that makes sense. Like, if I'm going to read a comedy, I would prefer something else, like As You Like It or even Twelfth Night. I would prefer to read that to get the scheming that Shakespeare is really good at doing. So what I wanted was for Act One, for that really, that magical charged element to carry through. And there are bits and pieces of it, especially in the way that Ariel is used and Caliban sort of makes appearances here and there. It's not sustained in the way that Act One led me to believe. And so therefore, it's not a favorite play. The ending, I feel like, was also very anticlimactic and did not do much for me at all as a reader. I usually love Shakespeare's endings, but this one just felt, I don't know. And maybe it's just because I was reading it for a research project, specifically wanting to look at Ariel and Caliban. And then I was like, oh my gosh, they're not even the focus. So maybe it's me. But those are sort of my feelings on The Tempest. I would love to hear your thoughts on The Tempest, because I've heard people say that it's their favorite play. And I would really love to hear other voices about it, because I'm just curious. I'm just going to move on to the final book that I read, which is Norwegian Wood by Haruki Murakami. Very exciting, because I have been wanting to read Murakami for years, probably. Finally picked it up. I don't know if this is where people would suggest that I start with Murakami. I didn't do the most research or anything into selecting my first one. This follows Toru, who is a university student that comes to Tokyo, and we basically follow him throughout, I believe, a couple of years of university. And one of the main things we're following is his relationship with Naoko, who is his best friend's ex-girlfriend, and this best friend did commit suicide when he was 17, and so the ex-girlfriend and Toru are the survivors of this group that was really close, because they would all hang out as a group of three. And so when his best friend dies, Naoko and Toru are sort of left, and they have this bond because of this, and they pursue this relationship that's also sort of complicated. And then one day Naoko disappears and Toru is left writing to her, trying to figure out where she is, and then he finds out where she is, but that might be a little bit more of a spoiler, maybe, I don't know. And so we are following him trying to navigate just growing up, and just the challenges that come with growing up is what we see him navigate. Friendships, relationships. He also meets this other young woman, Midori, but his relationship with her is very complicated because he is still waiting for Naoko. And so he's pursuing these sort of two different relationships, one with Naoko, which is a relationship that is very much at a distance and it's never really certain if they are going to be able to pursue it. And then one with Midori, who is very real and very present, and he is able to have a good time with her. And so it mainly centers around him following these two relationships, but it also is just about his experience at university, growing up, dealing with the challenges that he is presented with, and just, I think, finding his own identity in a world where things can feel meaningless, where things don't really make sense. And so the main focus of the book is Toru, but then also it does heavily center on these two relationships with these two women. I did really enjoy this, I think more than I thought I would. I always sort of wanted to read Murakami, but I was never hopeful that I would actually enjoy his writing. I don't know, it just, based on authors that I like and authors that I don't like, I think Murakami would have fallen into the category of authors that I don't really like, just based on my own reading experience and my own tastes. But I did really like this one. Not a favorite author based on this. I don't think I'm going to become a Murakami super fan based on my experience with this, but I did enjoy it, which I was surprised. I thought it did characterization really well. It really dove deep into Toru in a way that felt very intimate, and I thought that that was really well done. And I also did like the writing style. I thought for the themes that it was trying to portray, it was very appropriate. I do know that this does not have the surrealist elements that is in other Murakami books, and I do think that's where I wouldn't like Murakami. So I don't know if this is going to be the exception and not the rule, but I think I do have to just read more Murakami to find out, because I did like this, but also I do know that Norwegian Wood is the one that doesn't really have any of the classic Murakami surrealism that you would get, I think, in like Kafka on the Shore and Wild Sheep Chase, or like, there's one with talking cats, I don't know which one that is. But that being said, I really liked this and would recommend this. Again, don't know if it's the right place to start with Murakami, don't know if this means that I'm going to like his other works, or don't know if this means that I like this but won't like his other works? Don't know at all. But I did really like my experience with this book. I thought it was a good introduction to me to Murakami, because I think me diving into a super surrealist novel would have been too much, and I would have been probably not keen to pick up more Murakami. But I did like this experience, and I would read another Murakami book. So I think it succeeded as a place to start for me personally, and I did really enjoy it. And those are the four books that I read in the month of May. It was a very good reading month. I don't think I have a favorite out of the four particularly, but I did enjoy all of them. No new favorites, but no flops. But anyway, please let me know in the comments what your favorite book of the month was. I would love to hear it, and please sound off on any of these books. I would love to hear your thoughts, and thank you so much for watching, and I will see you in the next one.